My name is David Iglesias, and I'm the director of the Wheaton Center for Faith, Politics, and Economics. It's good to be here. We've got a tremendous presentation tonight. I'm sure some of you have probably heard Harry S. Truman was rumored to have said, if you want a friend in Washington, D.C., buy a dog. And we have two men on this stage who will absolutely contradict that because they maintained a friendship across partisan lines. So I'll be introducing them in a second. I have two staff members who will be passing out 3x5 cards. If you want to write questions, please do so on one side. If you want to be put on our mailing list, just turn it on the other side and provide us your information. We promise we will not sell this to Google, Apple, or any other large commercial concern. So let me introduce former members of Congress Tony Hall and Frank Wolf, and our moderator from the American Enterprise Institute, who is co-hosting this with the Center for Faith, Politics, and Economics. Our moderator tonight will be Meredith Schultz. Frank Wolf is the Distinguished Senior Fellow of the 21st Century Wilberforce Initiative, a newly created religious freedom advocacy group, and the first Wilson Chair in Religious Freedom at Baylor University. Mr. Wolf served as a member of the U.S. House of Representatives from 1980 until 2014. He is the author of the International Religious Freedom Act, which created the International Religious Freedom Office at the U.S. Department of State and established the bipartisan independent U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom. Wolf is the author of the legislation to create a special envoy at the State Department to advocate for religious minorities in the Near East and South Central Asia. Mr. Wolf founded and served as co-chairman of the Tom Lantos Human Rights Commission, a bipartisan organization comprised of nearly 200 members of Congress who work together to raise awareness about human rights issues internationally. And joining Mr. Wolf is Mr. Tony P. Hall, who is a leading advocate for hunger relief programs and improving human rights conditions in the world. He is currently serving as Executive Director Emeritus of the Alliance to End Hunger, which engages diverse institutions in building the public and political will to end hunger at home and abroad. In February of 2002, President George W. Bush asked him to serve as the United States Ambassador to the United Nations Agencies for Food and Agriculture. He was confirmed by the United States Senate, sworn in to office by Secretary of State Colin Powell in September of 2002, and retired in April of 2005. He retired from official diplomatic service in April of 2006, and prior to his diplomatic service, Ambassador Hall represented the 3rd District of Ohio, which I learned tonight is essentially Dayton, Ohio area. And for almost 24 years, Mr. Hall has been nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize 3 times. And the moderator tonight, again from the American Enterprise Institute for Public Policy Research in Washington, where she manages the Values and Capitalism Project, is AEI's outreach to Christian higher education. Meredith Schultz is a graduate of the Patrick Henry College, where she also worked as an assistant to the president and the provost. And prior to coming to AEI, she worked on Capitol Hill for Congressman Wolf, and also a graduate fellow of the Trinity Forum Academy on the Eastern Shore of Maryland. So without further ado, Ms. Schultz.
Thank you so much, Mr. Iglesias. You know, I'll never forget what my mother said when I went away for my first semester of college. She said, even though you're going to a Christian school, you still need to choose your friends wisely. And she was right, because friendship has power. For better or for worse, it can shape our priorities, it can shape our plausibilities structures, it can shape our sentiments. And so in the worst of times, we're reminded of St. Paul's warning to the Corinthians that bad company corrupts good morals. But I think in the best of times, it can look something like the friendship between Congressman Wolf and Ambassador Hall, which now spans over 3 decades of public service. So Mr. Wolf, Mr. Hall, thank you for being here tonight. And I want to start the conversation toward the beginning of the story, which is when you both started meeting together regularly with a handful of other members from across the aisle to pray. Can you tell me about how that group came together and sort of how it influenced your political careers?
Well, the group started. Anyway, it's good to be here at Wheaton, too. One of my kids, Virginia, is a graduate of Wheaton College, and her husband, Derek, is a graduate of Wheaton College, and they run a school in the inner city of Washington called the Cornerstone School. And in our group was another Wheaton graduate, Dan Coates. It was Tony and Dan Coates and another fellow, Bob McEwen, who Bob's wife, Liz McEwen, went to Wheaton, and myself. We got together to meet, and I was a little bit concerned because I had run for Congress in 1976 and had lost, and ran again in 1978 and lost again. And I came from what they call a targeted, very closely contested district. And I thought the fact that I'm going to sit in with a Democratic member and share my innermost thoughts just didn't really appeal to me. So it took a little while for us to. And so many things have come out of that group, the friendship that Tony and I have. In 81, 82, 83, and 84, if you look at all my work, I'm working on transportation, bringing rail to Dulles, transferring airports over. And in 85, it changes because in late 1984, Tony called me. He had just gotten back from Ethiopia. He said, "You got to go to Ethiopia. There's a famine," and he had just gotten back. And I got on an airplane and flew off to Ethiopia and got waylaid in a camp in Alamata, run by World Vision, and next to it was the camp that Mother Teresa was running. And the airplane couldn't come back to get me for a couple of days. And that was a life-changing event. And then in 85, Tony asked me to go with him to Romania. And Romania were the dark days of the Ceausescu administration, where people would come up and put notes in their hands saying, "My son is in prison, my husband is in prison." So the fellowship and the relationship that came out of our group and continues to this day really had a great impact. Had I not met Tony, had we not had those opportunities, then I think my whole course of action really in Congress would have been different. Lastly, my wife Carolyn and Tony's wife Jenna are in a small group together, meet together, pray together, and so the relationship has been special.
It is a special relationship, and we have been meeting for a number of years now. We started off just praying together and reading scripture, and we found that if we started to talk about issues or talk about politics, that would really separate us. And we're wondering, as politicians, well, what do we have to talk about? But you know, when you pray together and you talk about Jesus together, you know, it's kind of hard to get up after that and get mad at one another. And over time, by praying together and reading the scripture together and talking about our families and talking about, you know, we began to be intimate with one another. And over time, we began to trust one another. And then when you build the trust, you know, you can start to do things together. Then we found out that even though Frank is a Republican and I'm a Democrat, we had a lot of interests that were the same and that we could work on together, like family issues and trafficking and women issues and hunger issues and anti-gambling issues, et cetera. And so over time, we found that prayer, reading the scripture, really helped. Politics would not bring us together, but that would bring us together.
Now, but these issues of caring for the poor and vulnerable weren't always on your radar. When you first started out in Congress, you weren't a believer at that point. And then you took this first trip to Ethiopia in 1984, and it seemed like everything changed after that. So what was it about that trip that really changed your perspective?
Well, like you said, I was not a believer when I went to Congress, and I had to go to the Congress of the United States to find Jesus. I always get that reaction. People always laugh. I remember when I had first become a believer, and this friend of mine introduced me to this audience, and he was so excited. He said, "I want to introduce Tony Hall. He's a U.S. congressman and a Christian." And you know, people started to giggle in the back. And an older man down front, he's kind of squirming in his chair, and he couldn't take it any longer, and he hollered up. He said, "Make up your mind, buddy, you can't be both." Anyway, I won't go into how I became a believer, but I became a believer my freshman year in Congress, and I was really searching, and I was empty. I mean, I was successful, but I was empty in my life, and I had a great wife, have a great wife, two great children, and was successful, but I was vague, and I didn't like the way I was going, and so I went on a search for God, and I found him through Jesus. And then what happened was, probably from my Peace Corps days, I've always had this feeling towards wanting to help other people, especially people that are hurting. And I was drawn to orphans and widows and hunger and people that are really, you know, what Jesus talks about when he says the least of these. And so I became chairman over a period of time of the Select Committee on Hunger, and it was my job to travel a little bit, and the first trip I took to was Ethiopia that Frank was talking about. And I saw 25 children die one morning from hunger. And I was stunned. As a matter of fact, as I walked among these people that were dying, there was over 10,000 of these people. There was a civil war, and prior to the Civil War, there was a drought, and then because of the Civil War, it turned into a famine. And as a result, this government and this whole country was in chaos. And people were just leaving their homes because they were looking for food and medicines and blankets, water. And they found themselves on a high plateau, at least about 10,000 of them, and I happened to be there at the same time. And it was Mother Teresa's group had a little clinic there. And I went in there, and then a traveling doctor was there, and he said, "Come with me outside. I don't think you've seen this before." So I walked among these people, and the mothers are handing me their dead children, thinking I was a doctor, thinking I could save them. You know, I had to put my sunglasses on because tears were coming down my face. I didn't know how to handle it. And for the next 3 days, this is all I saw, was just these people dying left and right. I've never seen death like that. And I came back from that experience. Of course, first thing I did is call Frank. And then as I began to read the scriptures, you know, God is very clear about this. There's over 2,500 verses in the Bible that deal with the issue of the sick, the hurting, the alien, the orphan, the widow, the hungry. God is very clear. He wants us involved. And so I thought, you know, this is what I'm going to concentrate on. Outside of taking care of my district, this is what I'm going to do. So that's kind of how Frank and I got started, through praying, reading the scripture, and then taking trips together and going to Romania, our wives getting to know one another. And just over time, this trust began to come in.
Talking about these international hunger issues that are so heartbreaking. I mean, you're watching children die on television. And so the desire is to come in quickly and to bring aid and to bring relief. We do know that in the long term, this relief aid can have unintended consequences on foreign markets. In 2010, after the earthquake in Haiti, a lot of foreign rice came in, and it actually put local growers out of business, and it made it more difficult for the economy to recover there. So how can we address these real crises without destabilizing fragile economies?
We have to be careful, and I think the United States government and our NGOs are much better at what we do now than what we were 20 years ago. And we did disrupt markets. We would sometimes, instead of buying food locally in Africa or in Haiti or wherever and support the farmers that are already there, we would sometimes bring our own food in or into a country where the farmers were already growing it. And it became a stuffability problem, you know, where we'd bring our own food in and it would just kill the prices of the farmers there. And so we really learned our lesson because we hurt a lot of people that way. We've changed a lot. We have a lot of great NGOs. Our government has changed. Actually, these programs that we have now, school feeding, hunger programs, agriculture programs, better seeds, water programs, better sanitation programs, teaching mothers how to read and write, they work. We have cut poverty in half in the world. And 35 years ago, I used to say, today, 42,000 people are going to die from hunger and hunger-related deaths. Now, I say, today, 21,000 people will die. So it's still a lot of people. Mm-hmm. But we are making progress. And these programs and things that we're doing are actually working. And there's a lot of fine organizations out there that are making it happen.
Now, you've worked on hunger issues domestically quite a bit. And in 1993, you were on the House Select Committee on Hunger, right as the House abolished it. And in response to that, you fasted for 22 days. What happened during that time?
Well, I got mad at my colleagues. What happened was that Congress eliminated my committee. I, at that time, had become chairman of the full committee, and my committee was the committee that actually started microcredit, microfinance. And we started immunization of children. We started the Child Survival Fund, and Frank helped me start that. We started the fund to teach mothers how to read and write overseas. We started school feeding programs. I mean, we started a lot of programs, legislation that's in law today. Well, anyway, to make a long story short, Congress had, like we do today, we had high deficits, and we needed to do something about it. So oftentimes what happens in a political world, in a political situation, we sometimes throw the baby out with the bathwater. And what they did is they said, look, we're going to start living within our means. We'll start eliminating some of the waste and stuff we do up here. We'll send the money back to the American people, and we'll make everybody happy. So the first thing they did was eliminate my committee and said, we're going to send the money back to the American people. Well, they eliminated my committee, but they kept the money and spread it among the other committees. Oh, my gosh. Now I'm so mad. I don't know what to do. Because it was the only committee in Congress that really dealt with the issue of hunger. So I went home that night and talked to my wife, and I said, Jan, I'm thinking about quitting Congress because, you know, these people don't really care about this issue, and I don't know what to do about it. And she said, did you ever think about fasting? I'm thinking, oh, my wife is crazy here now. So she went and got her Bible, and we read Isaiah 58. Isaiah 58 is a wonderful chapter on fasting, as you know. And we read it, we prayed about it, and I called a few people that were brothers, and I said, what do you think? I'm thinking about going on a fast. And so my wife was with me, a few of my friends were with me. The next day, I went before Congress and announced that I was going to fast, that I was just going to drink water, and I was not going to eat anything, and I was going to go a long time. I didn't know how long. I actually went 22 days without eating. And I was going to wait until something good happened. Of course, you know, there must have been 30 TV cameras there. And what happened was really amazing. God was so strong, so on top of it, because all I did was stop eating. And so many good things happened. Like, there were 10,000 high schools that fasted with me, 200 universities. Now, they didn't fast for 22 days. They'd fast for a couple days. But the press began to write about it in a very good way, and then the congressman began to really respond now, because a lot of them had really kind of deserted me, because they thought, this guy is crazy. I mean, he's fasting and nuts. Who would ever do something like this? Now they're seeing the publicity, and it's all good. Now they want to be part of it. So a lot of good things were happening, and I'm still waiting for something amazingly. I want to see something really good before I quit. And so the World Bank, which is the largest development bank in the world, they called me and said, we really like, we're reading about what you're doing in the New York Times, the Washington Post, and we want to have a conference based on your fast. We're going to invite a lot of heads of state, want you to come. You make a good speech, we will maybe commit some money. So I went, and they had a lot of heads of state. Jimmy Carter came, and the Secretary General, Boutros-Ghali, interesting name. He came, and they committed $100 million to my fast. And $100 million went out for microcredit to women all over the world, and mostly to developing nations. And they tell me that $100 million is now up to $500 million, because the money went out, 98% of it was paid back. It was paid back with interest, and then it went out again, and it went out again, and all of these women across the world produced all these jobs and started these new small businesses, and one fast. I had no campaign, no money, no team, except my wife and a few people that had supported me. And God did the rest. It was an incredible time.
Were you ever discouraged at all during the fast? Were there any doubts that you had during that time?
Say that again?
Were you ever discouraged during your fast at any point? Was there ever a dark time during those 22 days when you weren't sure if you had made the right decision?
Yeah, the dark part was the first 7 days. I was so hungry. And once you go through the 7 days, once you get past the 7 days, you're not hungry anymore. Your body begins to lie to you. It begins to start to eat whatever's left in your body, and you're not hungry. And I never understood that, because I never understood why you have to force feed somebody. You go to a refugee camp and you'll see a tube down a little child's nose, and we're force feeding them. So why do we do that? Why don't we just give them the food? They'll eat. They said, well, you can put food in front of them, they'll never eat, mm-hmm. because their body begins to tell them they don't need to eat. So you have to force feed them to keep them alive. That's the way I was. But the other thing that was very hard the first 7 days was that nobody was coming to my defense. And everybody had left me, and I was thinking, I'm really stupid. I've really made a mistake. Not really made a mistake, but I just wasn't seeing anything in the first 7 days, and it was terribly lonely. And then it just took off. It just took off. It was amazing. God was so clear, so strong. My wife said to me, she said, you had a glow about you during those 22 days that I've never seen before. She said, now, I haven't seen it since. She said, but it was amazing to see it. And I felt it. I felt that glow. When you fast and pray, as many of you know, when you fast and pray, God leans a little bit closer to you. Because you're saying to him, this is important, I want you to listen, I'm fasting unto you. It's important to fast unto him, not unto hunger, but unto him first. Then the clouds part.
It's hard to move on from that topic, but let's talk for a little bit about Romania and China and the most favored nation trade battles. Now, both of you worked together across the aisle to deny most favored nation trading status to these two countries because of the human rights abuses that were occurring there. and these stands that you took really put you at odds with the business community. And so how do you respond to the argument that greater economic freedom and free trade will eventually lead to other freedoms, freedom of the press, freedom of conscience, freedom of speech? What would you say to people who make that argument?
Two things. One, back to the beginning, a small group does get, when it says in the Bible, when one falls down, the other helps them up. And I think to be in a group of accountability, and we gain strength from being in it on the issue of China and on MFN for Romania, our working together was so unique that we were able to pass it in the House, pass it in the Senate, and President Reagan, to his credit, removed MFN from Romania, which I believe helped bring down Romania. The argument that by economic trade and everything, things open up and everything is wonderful, really isn't true. We have given China everything. Everything. Now today, there are Catholic bishops in China under house arrest. There are hundreds and hundreds of Protestant pastors that are in China under house arrest. There are 130 Buddhist monks and nuns. In 1996, I snuck into Tibet with a young Tibetan monk. We went back into the monasteries and the bowels of the monastery. Every monastery has a public security police guarding it. In the last year, 130 Buddhist monks and nuns have poured kerosene on their bodies and lit a match in protest of what the Chinese are doing, and the world is silent. The Uyghurs, Reba Kadir, who lived in my area, her son has been in jail, just got out about 6 months ago, was in it for four or five years. Zhao Bo, the 2010 Nobel Prize winner, is in jail and nobody even says anything. So things are worse. The Chinese stripped my computer, took everything off of my computer. They're spying against us. Just read they took every anyone who's ever worked for the federal government, the moderator, you work for the Chinese have your records. If you were at the CIA and don't have the security background, the Chinese have the records. So it hasn't helped. China, the conditions are worse today than they were during Tiananmen. And so it did not change China. What changed China? What would change is if we had a president like President Reagan. President Reagan said that the words in the Constitution and the words in the Declaration of Independence were a covenant not only with the people in Philadelphia in 1776, but and a covenant with the people in Philadelphia during the Constitution in 1787, but a covenant with the entire world, a covenant with the tank man in Tiananmen, a covenant with the Christians who are being persecuted now in Iraq, a covenant with the Christians in Nigeria, a covenant with the Baha'is in Iran are being arrested. And what took place, what we had in those days, we had a bipartisan, and Tony was part of it, Chris Smith was part of it, Henry Hyde was part of it, Scoop Jackson, a Democrat, was part of it, Tom Lantos was part of it. We had a bipartisan working on human rights and religious freedom. And we were together. We were together. And now neither party, neither administration, this administration, nor the Congress really is. So that is not true. All you have to go talk to anyone in China. Conditions are worse. The trade imbalance with China is so high, but the conditions are worse. During the Reagan days, the American embassy in Beijing was an island of freedom. When a Chinese dissident got to the American embassy, he knew they were going to be advocated for, they were going to be protected. Those days are over. So it isn't trade. It isn't trade. It's speaking out for the Sharansky's, for the Sakharovs. And so right now, we have seen the conditions in China are worse today than they've been for the last 20 years. And yet the trade imbalance is so high. How many of you have an iPhone? An iPhone, do you know where this iPhone is made? It's made in China at a place called Foxconn, where the suicide rate is so high that they put nets around the building because Chinese workers are diving out to commit suicide. The internet cafes are controlled by the secret police. They're taking crosses down. So trade has not what makes and would change China as a different meaning for the president and the Congress to speaking out for human rights and religious freedom, not just for Christians. There's growing anti-Semitism around the world, for the Baha'is, for the Ahmadis, for all that. And we are not seeing it today because both political parties are failing. So trade will not change China. It has made China actually worse.
And what about Romania? How did the battle over MFN go down there?
Well, I come from Virginia, we had heavy coal. We had different groups come by, say we were gonna hurt the coal industry. I think what helped us was having Tony, a Democrat, and me, a Republican, but we pushed and pushed, we passed it in the House. We had a guy named Danny Rostikowski, who some of you may know from this region, who strongly opposed us, sort of ridiculed us. We finally passed it in the House, it came up in the Senate, and I don't know if it's been done. Tony and I walked over to the Senate. Being a House member, you have the right to go on the Senate floor. We went on the Senate floor together, a Democrat and a Republican, advocating, pushing, and we were able to pass it. And President Reagan, to his credit, then went to pass, revoked MFN by executive order. And many people think that was the beginning downfall of the Ceausescu government. Mm-hmm. We were trading. The coal people in Southern Virginia were trading. Many were trading. We gave them MFN, and it was not changing. Romania, Bucharest was darker by kilowatt and darker with evil than any other place behind the Soviet Union. So trade was not making Ceausescu a better person. They were taking advantage of it and persecuting the people. It didn't work there either. And by taking it away, I believe it helped bring back down. When the revolution broke out in 89, I jumped on an airplane and was there to see and the freedom that they came. So trade has not made the difference and did not make the difference in Romania, and in some respects has made conditions worse now in China.
And Mr. Wolf, you have a reputation for traveling to some dangerous places. Romania is one, Tibet is one. You were very recently in Nigeria, which many of you know, Boko Haram notoriously kidnapped about 300 young schoolgirls in 2014. I think only 60 or so have been found. So what did you see when you were in Nigeria, and what are the conditions like for religious minorities there?
We were there 2 weeks ago. We went up in a Boko Haram area. The conditions are horrible. The Christians are living a miserable life. Of the young girls who have been kidnapped, actually, we were told when we met with their families, none of them have actually come back. They're also counseling the parents that, one, your daughter will probably never come back. If she comes back, she will have been raped over and over and over. Thirdly, she will have been pregnant and probably have a child. And lastly, she will be forcibly made to convert to Islam. Some of the parents take the attitude that it might be better, you know. Boko Haram, when we were there, there's a village called Agetu, A-G-A-T-U, where they went in, 200 people to 500 people were killed. And the one question that the church asked over and over the ministers, because they're burning churches, they're burning villages, is they said, Mr. Wolf, does the church in the West care about us? There are 170 million people in Nigeria. A majority are Christians, and they feel almost forgotten about. And to keep in mind, Boko Haram has signed an agreement with ISIS, and they are part of ISIS. They are destabilizing the Cameroon. There were two French soldiers killed 2 weeks ago. They're destabilizing Niger, the Central African Republic, even Benin. And now there's another group called the Fulani herdsmen who are all Muslims who are coming in and equally doing that. And lastly, the government itself is somewhat corrupt and the police are not advocating. So I guess the message that they said over, we're going to file a report, we're going to issue, we took pictures and we have interviews. We hope to be bringing one of the mothers over when we give our report. But I guess what I would say to all of you is the church in Nigeria is asking, does the church in the West care? And I think for America, we should be standing up and speaking out. They need help. In some villages, they're eating grass. They're eating almost nothing. They need food. They need medicine. They need support. They need our government to put pressure on the Nigerian government to respect human rights and religious freedom. They need some military assistance, not to fight, but aerial drones to find Boko Haram. But overall, I think the most important thing, the church in the West, there's a large Anglican population. The Anglicans in America should be helping the Anglicans there. The Baptists here should be helping the Baptists here. The Catholic Church here should be helping the Catholics here. But they are really looking for someone, and they can't get any attention in the world. And you're finding people who are being hacked to death, and it's about as bad. Actually, Boko Haram is in some respects more violent than ISIS.
So just today, you had actually told me that Secretary Kerry decided to designate the atrocities being committed in Iraq as genocide. So why is that significant?
Well, we went to Iraq last year. We went in the area. You know, more biblical activity for those of us who are Christians. More biblical activity took place in Iraq than any other country of the world other than Israel. Abraham is from Nasiriyah. My first trip, I was in Nasiriyah. They said, this is Ur. They took me to the site of Abraham's village. Ezekiel's buried there. Daniel's buried there. Rebecca is from there. The 12 tribes of Israel is from there. We were out there this last week. We went in a little village in the front line. I touched Nahum's tomb in El Kush. Jonah's tomb was blown up. The Christian community has gone from 1.5 million down to 250,000, and I am very grateful. I'm not a supporter of this administration, but I'm very grateful, and said today before I left Washington, I thank Secretary Kerry. I thank also Ambassador Saperstein, who has been he's a religious freedom ambassador, and also a fellow, we passed a bill to set up a special envoy, a fellow named Knox Thames, for the work that they did. But by calling it genocide, we honor those who have been killed. We also aid those who want to leave, because now if you can say, I'm from an area where they're committing genocide, there'll be a greater opportunity for them to leave. Thirdly, many of the Christians there do not want to leave. They love their country. They don't want to leave. And so it'll enable us to give more support for them. And the last two issues are, anyone who's fighting for ISIS will now be guilty of genocide and can be brought up before the International Criminal Court. And lastly, we were told that there were prominent Saudis who were helping ISIS, Qatar was helping ISIS, and Turkey was allowing Western foreign fighters to come to Istanbul, reposition, and go south and join ISIS. For Turkey to allow that to happen, for anyone from Saudi Arabia to be helping, or Qatar, they will be able to be charged with genocide. So it is a very, very big deal. There's a saying in the Middle East, first the Saudi people, and then the Sunni people. The Jewish population of Iraq in 1950 was 150,000. When I was there last year, I said, how many Jewish people are left? They said, Mr. Wolf, there are 10 Jewish individuals left, and it may be down to 4. What took place to the Jewish community is taking place to the Christian community. 17 Christian families leave every day. So by Secretary Kerry today, and I thank him for doing it, by him calling this genocide, it can be a game changer, if you will, because there's a Catholic group out of London a couple of months ago said in 6 years there will be no Christians left in the cradle of Christendom. And so this may be a game changer whereby we can enable Christianity to still flourish and be available. But short of that, we will see no more Christians left. So it's a good thing that Secretary Kerry did today. And also, that was the other question. We were the Catholic nun, Sister Diana. She kind of asked the same question. She said, Mr. Wolf, does the church in the West care? And Pope Francis has called it genocide. Cardinal Dolan called it genocide. Cardinal Worrell called it genocide. Ken Starr from Baylor called it genocide. Rick Warren called it genocide. But overall, the church in the West has been relatively silent. We all missed the genocide in Cambodia. We missed the genocide in Srebrenica. We missed the genocide in Rwanda. Tony was in Rwanda, saw bodies floating down the river. The difference is the genocide people in those countries were hiding it. ISIS is not hiding this. So had we missed this, it would have been very, very difficult to even live down. You may remember, if you read Eric McTax's book, he said, Dietrich Bonhoeffer said, in the face of evil, not to speak is to speak, and not to act is to act. And so I think for us not to have spoken and acted would have really been a judgment, I think, on us. So I think Secretary Kerry did the right thing.
So how can the church be acting effectively? How could a college student be advocating in this space?
Well, I tell you, there's several things. One, you can pray. Two, you can help groups that are there. The two groups in Iraq that are doing tremendous work, the Dominican nuns and Franklin Graham's Samaritan's Purse. Those two groups are doing amazing, amazing work. You can adopt little villages working through Franklin Graham's group. You can adopt working for the Catholic Church, the Sister Diana, the Dominican nuns. There's a lot that can be done. And also, by putting pressure on our government to be assistance, because there is a group of Christians, and the other group is, we cannot forget, the Yazidis. The Yazidis have been having a very difficult time. The Christians there and the Yazidis and some Turkmen have come together, and they want to have a Nineveh Plains protectorate whereby they can stay, and they've created what they call a National Guard. They're not going to be the point of spear against ISIS, but they want to protect their own village. So by you advocating with your congressmen and with your senators to aid them with regard to the protected can make a big difference. So you, both in Nigeria, you can help, and you can also help in the northern Iraq area.
So both of you are best known for this work, for religious persecution, for global hunger. But you were both congressmen for a number of years, and so you represented districts that had much more local concerns. So did you ever find that your commitment to your constituents and your commitment to a broader global constituency were ever in tension? And maybe what did you do to help care for the poor and vulnerable in your districts?
Well, I found that I had to bring the issue back home, that if I traveled overseas, oftentimes I would get letters or phone calls, hey, you know, how's come you're in Ethiopia or the Congo or North Korea? Don't you think you ought to be spending more time in Ohio taking care of our problems? And after I got lots of letters like that and phone calls, I thought, you know, I got to bring this issue home. And so what I did is I started a lot of programs in Dayton, Ohio. I started gleaning programs. I started pickup of food programs. I started a senior citizen feeding program during the cold winter months. I started immunization programs. And these lasted for 15 to 20 years. We had lots of volunteers. I got a lot of the corporations, labor groups involved. And when I did that, it really, really made a difference. I had asked, I had done a poll in my district when I first took office, and I asked people to rank these issues. I listed 20 issues. I said, rank these issues according to 1 through 20, which was the most important, you know, deficit, defense, budget, whatever, environment. And poverty and hunger ranked like 18th and 19th. I did the same poll when I left 24 years later. I wanted to see where people were after we had started all these programs. And poverty and hunger ranked number 2 and 3. Hmm. My point is that it's the job of the elected official, I think, to educate and to bring people along and to bring the issue home and to not only bring the issue home, but get people involved in it. And when you do that, people respond in a very good way.
Yeah, I never had any trouble. Once in a while at a town hall meeting, somebody who maybe didn't like a voter. I always, in my 34 years, I published every vote that I ever cast. Everybody could, at the end of the year, I put out a big, thick mailing on every single vote that I cast, so everyone knew how I voted. And overall, my district was very, very good. I'm a conservative Republican. You know, they knew it. I have not hidden my faith. I believe that I will be held accountable at the end of the day on what I have done and stand before the Lord. And I would tell people, and so no, it did not create a problem. Once in a while, somebody may say something. They were probably angry, not at that, but at something else. And Tony gave me the idea. We met with my food banks. I was the author of the National Commission that just Tony was involved in to see how we can end hunger, and they just reported. I was the author of the Chuck Colson Prison Reform Commission, so I did everything else. But I really never had, you know, you don't go to the Paris Air Show, you go to Ethiopia. But I never had anybody really, you know, get mad at me except once or twice somebody would say something, and I think it was just a way to kind of make a point. But no, it did not hurt me politically.
You mentioned criminal justice reform and sort of the prison rape issues, and that's really coming to the fore right now in this election. Can you talk about what you did on prison rape?
I was the author. I used to call Chuck Colson. One of my kids worked for Colson, and one of my other daughters, Brenna, married a fellow who was one of Chuck's top people. They run a Christian school up in Princeton called the William Wilberforce School. I used to call Chuck a lot. Chuck Colson combined the hard-headed reality of politics. If you remember, he made the comment he would walk over his mother's grave to help the grandmother's grave to help Nixon, but with the faith that he had in Christ. And so the combination. And so I would talk to Chuck, you know, a lot on different, you know, votes I think it all worked out well. I think when people know, as Tony was saying earlier, the people know that you care about an issue and you're willing to kind of articulate it and say what your position is and how you feel about it. I think it's fine.
So now, it took William Wilberforce 46 years to abolish the slave trade in Great Britain. And with a lot of your work, it's similarly grueling, and there's a lot of disappointment. So what would you say to those who are working in the trenches of a particular issue or for a cause, for the poor and vulnerable, but are feeling disillusioned or burned out? And where have you seen signs of hope in your career?
Well, I said earlier that we actually are making progress in hunger and in poverty and development assistance. When I say we, this worldwide network of various governments and nonprofits and various organizations have cut poverty in half. And that was thought to be impossible 10 years ago. That has actually happened. They've cut infant mortality rates and the number of people dying per day from 42,000 down to now 21,000 a day. Still a lot, but it's a significant cut. These programs that we're talking about, they work, and they absolutely work. I think the problem that I have, the frustrating part about this issue, is that this issue of hunger is not a big issue among our elected officials. It's the people that we represent, the people that we care about, are really voiceless. They don't have a lot of people knocking on doors in the Congress saying, "We need your help," because poor people don't get audiences with congressmen and senators. They don't have political PACs, they don't have money. They're not particularly great voters, and they are the voiceless. So the one frustration that I have, it's not particularly a big issue. We're trying to make it a big issue. Bread for the World has got a major campaign out this year, Vote to End Hunger, and I think it's an appropriate year to really come out with a campaign like that. And the thing that makes the difference, though, is our faith, is Frank's faith, my faith. That's the thing that keeps us, that gets us up in the morning. That's the thing that keeps us going. That's the thing that we know that we're doing what God wants us to do. He's given us this position. He's given us positions to do something about it, and we can do something about it. And we can go to bed at night, and this is not bad. We can go to bed at night, and at the end of the week or something, we can say, you know what? We helped a few people today. Now, how many people get to say that in their life? And that's not bad. God allows us to work on things that help people. And I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful for this issue. I'm thankful for God leading us to this issue. I want to do more, and but I'm thankful for my faith, because I had to come to the Congress of the United States to find Jesus. It's pretty amazing, isn't it?
I'd say so.
I thank God for the opportunity. I still stutter. I stuttered really bad. And people would laugh at me. I want to be in Congress since I was in third grade. And so the thought that I got to serve in Congress, it just can't, I mean, even now I get into a stuttering block if I'm really tired. I just thank God for the opportunity. But I got it, my wife, we have five kids. I've been married for 55 years. I have 16 grandkids. I'm concerned for the country. I left Congress more out of, I felt a stranger in Congress. I felt alone. He was gone. Coats had moved off. I felt alone. There were times I'd be on the floor, I felt like a stranger. 34 years, I felt less at home there. And I'm worried about a country. I think, you know, God's in control. But when I see things, record debt and no one willing to come together to deal with it. I was the author of the National Commission Against Pornography. And now, two clicks away on a cell phone, we have a pornography problem. I was the author of the National Commission Against Gambling. We got gambling in 40, you'll be able to go to Washington now and go to the big gambling casino at the Woodrow Wilson Bridge, and you can buy marijuana if you want to do on your way. I mean, I see things going. I see less of interest in the issue of human rights and religious freedom. You know, it used to be a bipartisan issue. So I think the country is in trouble. I think I'd be less than I'm hopeful, but I'm not optimistic. I pray every night for a spiritual awakening, for something to come into this country and awaken. And so I think we are facing some really very, very difficult times. So I thank God for the opportunity that I get to serve. Sometimes my wife and I, you know, we'll sit around and we'll look at a couple of our grandkids and see. But when I see where it was when I started, where it was when I left, and all you have to do is watch this latest, almost the presidential debates are almost like that if my mom and dad, you know, my dad loved politics, if he ever, I mean, so something is happening in the country, and I'm worried, I'm concerned. And I think, I look at it, the young people, relay races are won or lost in the passing of the baton. My generation is leaving. I'm 77 years old. We're passing the baton to your generation, and hopefully your generation will, you know, as other generations have done. There are great people in this country, but for some reason we're seeing, and maybe I'm alone, maybe none of you out there completely agree with me, but we're seeing things that I never thought I would kind of see in the country. So when I left Congress, I left in grave disappointment. I almost felt like a stranger in a land that I had been in for years, and I really had nothing. So we'll kind of see, you know, where this all comes out. But the country has some very difficult times. And I think those of you who are a little older will understand that things haven't always been the way that they are. I'll leave you with the one thing. President Reagan, one of the greatest presidents we ever had. Reagan shot. They go to the George Washington Hospital. Tip O'Neill goes visit him and prays with him. Can you see that happening today? So, but God can do whatever he wants to do.
Why don't we take a few questions from the audience? I know that we had some note cards passed out, so I think David's going to moderate some Q&A for us.
Well, please join us in thanking our guests for their observations tonight. So as you're thinking about your question and writing it down, we've got Sammy and Heidi. Please pass your question down to them. While you're doing that, I have a question for Mr. Wolf. You mentioned that the church is not vocal about the global persecution, the church here in the United States and in the West. Do you have any thoughts on why that is? And how can someone in the audience become involved in registering their concern about the global persecution of the church?
Well, everything that takes place in Congress is downstream from culture, and the pulpit has an impact on the culture. And the church was, the Jewish community in the 80s activated for Soviet Jewry and did so much. It was a rally on the Mall. 275,000 people came, and Ronald Reagan spoke, and it was right, left, liberal, conservative, and you're just not really kind of seeing it. There are a lot of good groups. Open Doors, a wonderful, wonderful group. Voice of the Martyrs, a wonderful group. There are a number of groups out there who were doing. We were in one little village in Nigeria, the poorest of the place, and they said they were literally existing on the support that they were having for voice from the Voice of the Martyrs. You can also adopt a prisoner. There's a woman, Asia Bibi, A-S-I-A-B-B, who's a Christian woman who is in prison under a death sentence, not a charge. Sentence, has been in it for six years. 6 years, and we give Pakistan billions of dollars. And no one ever raises a case. You could write letters to the Pakistani government. You could write letters to the Pakistani ambassador. You could write letters to your congressman. There is so much that you could do. But let me tell you, the average congressional office, if they get 15 letters on a subject, the staff comes in and says, Congressman, we just got all, you have within you the power to do amazing things. And so there's so much that you could do. And I put in a good word for Open Doors. I could have put a good in work for the Catholic Conference. I put a good work in for Samaritan's Purse. I put a good word in for some of those groups. And even, again, and one of the ways that I kind of, by going and visiting and seeing and hearing and touching and smelling and hearing the stories of the people, to give, to take a time off in some summer, to go with Samaritan's Purse, to go with World Vision. But I think there's so many things that you can do. And lastly, pray. I think the prayer, I was once in a place called Marco Polo restaurant in my district, and a lady asked me, Mr. Wolf, why did the Soviet Union fall? And I said, well, the Soviet Union fell because, and I gave her a traditional Republican answer. I said, the cruise missiles and all. She said, no. She said, it fell because we've been praying for the defeat of communism. And I said, oh my goodness, my mom and dad taught me to pray for the I prayed in a rote way for the defeat of communism since I was a little kid. So the power of prayer can make a tremendous difference too. There's so much that you can do.
Thank you. Here's one for Ambassador Hall. Are there organizations that encourage bipartisan cooperation? What can we do to reverse the deadlock in our government?
I think you should really confront your congressmen and senators, your mayors, your state representatives and state senators. I think first you should go see them personally, and talk to them and tell them, number one, you're praying for them, and two, ask him to vote for these kind of issues that we're talking about today. and study up on these issues, and ask him to do something. If you're involved in a food bank or a soup kitchen or trafficking in women, or whatever, some of the issues that Frank is talking about, ask him to go see these programs. Ask him to get involved in it. And then follow up. Ask him to maybe, if they're a Republican, they should adopt a Democrat. And pray with him. Ask him to do that. You know, it's pretty easy to pray with another Republican, or a Democrat to pray with a Democrat. But ask a Republican to adopt a Democrat and stop this partisan fighting and bickering. It's hurting our country. You can do that. Let me tell you something about congressmen and senators and people that run for office. They react because they react to voters. And if you don't talk to them, if you don't write them letters or emails, if you don't let them know what you think, they kind of feel, well, nobody writes me about this issue. It must be okay. I can vote the way I want to vote. You have to ask them. You have to talk to them. You have to push them. Ask him to adopt a Democrat. Ask him to adopt a Republican. Ask him to pray together. You know, when you pray together, it's hard to get mad at one another.
Mr. Wolf, what has been Congress's reaction to the call for greater action on religious freedom? A group of leaders, including Ken Starr, sent a letter to congressional leaders back in July urging for greater action. Has there been any movement?
I sense some positive movement. The House on Monday passed a resolution, House Con Res 75, to declare what is taking place in the Middle East and in Iraq and in Syria genocide, which was a very, very positive thing. That probably put a little pressure on Secretary Kerry, though I don't want to take anything away from Secretary Kerry. I want to give him, you know, the praise for doing what he did. So I see a little thing. I really do believe, though, and we're at Wheaton College, I do believe the Congress will have to pass. Madison said the most sacred of all property is conscience. We need to pass something that will protect freedom of conscience. My conscience drives me to do what I do, and I'm concerned that religious institutions and religious schools are going to begin to lose their tax-exempt status, and I see some very dangerous things coming. So we're not getting involved in the Supreme Court decision, all those things, but there needs to be space for people of faith, of all faiths, or no faith at all, if you will. And I think that the faith community needs to come together. We're putting a private gathering on May 4th. We're bringing some of the thought leaders together on how do we move the culture, not political, the culture on the issue of religious freedom / conscience. Because there's a great book to read by Karen Swallow Pryor, who teaches at Liberty University. It's called Hannah Moore. Wilberforce and the Clapham Society moved the British society and opinion. It took, as Myrna said, all those years. But even Christians in those days favored slavery or didn't want to take it on because they didn't want to offend the slave traders. But using pottery, Josiah Moore, you remember the Am I Not a Man? And you remember that? They use art and everything else. And so we're trying to think, how do we do things? And there's a poll out that I saw that's not out yet that shows that 69% of Americans favor religious freedom / conscience. But it must be done in a winsome way. It can't be my way or that. It's winsome. So we're trying to bring these people. We're having Robbie George and Oz Guinness and others. How do we move the culture in a winsome way? But I believe, if particularly with the death of Justice Scalia, who was a constituent of mine, I think we're going to begin to lose more cases, and I think religious institutions of all backgrounds are going to begin to have some very dangerous issues come up that are going to impact. So I think we need to pass a space whereby institutions and people of conscience can protect that conscience, because I believe, and if my one of my favorite books is it's John F. Kennedy, Profiles of Courage, and Robert Bolt's play, A Man for All Seasons. I mean, Thomas More went to the gallows because of his conscience, and people have strong faith and he believes. So there needs to be some way to protect that conscience so that we're not forced to do things. But I think religious institutions are going to have to come together, and that Congress could pass that, I think, in a bipartisan way, but I don't see any kind of movement up on the Hill to kind of do that. But short of that, I think some different times are coming for Christian institutions in the next 5 years.
Ambassador Hall, you both worked on international hunger issues while you were in Congress. We're now seeing the high rates of hunger in America. Do we need a coalition of Congress people to work on domestic hunger issues?
Well, we sure do. I have a big hunger problem in my own district in Dayton, Ohio. As a matter of fact, I've been called back to Dayton by some of my citizens to start some programs all over again. Dayton, Ohio is now the fourth hungriest city in the country. And I lost 40,000 manufacturing jobs there. And these were jobs that paid $27 an hour before benefits. And these jobs, these people that made $27 an hour are now making $8 or $9 an hour. Well, they're now making it. And they're finding themselves going to food banks and food pantries. And this is why we have 48 million people in our country today that are hungry. 48 million in this great country of America. Now, the hunger here is not the kind of hunger that we see in South Sudan or the Congo or Ethiopia or even North Korea. I mean, our people are not dropping over dead. But what they are is 3 days out of every month, they're going to a food pantry or a food bank asking for food. And it's mostly women and children and senior citizens. And after they pay their rent, after they pay their utility bill, after they pay their daycare bill, they run out of money. And they are not going to the dentist. Their kids are, if they get sick, they oftentimes stay sick, or the mother just doesn't take care of her health. And if they have a catastrophe during the month, they're in trouble. These are the 48 million people that we're talking about. So we have a domestic hunger problem here in America. And it's really hit in my own district. And I'm going back to start programs, bring business in and bring the nonprofits in and bring the universities in, bring the hospitals in, and start an advisory committee. I'm gonna study it, and this advisory committee is gonna study it. We're gonna come up with a plan, and we're gonna do it. And because I don't wanna be from a city that is the fourth hungriest city in the country, when we used to be number one. We had a hunger-free city in 2000. So in 15, 16 years, we are now one of the hungriest cities in the country. So yeah, we've got a problem in America. It's not just overseas.
Mr. Wolf, what is the potential for future bipartisan efforts to end the highly problematic war on drugs that has resulted in overinflated prisons and the highest prison population in the world?
Well, very good, because I was the author of the Chuck Colson Prison Reform Commission. The moderator was on the commission. They came out with some, I think you would acknowledge, some very good recommendations. It is bipartisan. Speaker Ryan supports them. Senator Grassley supports him, Orrin Hatch supports him. So my expectations are, although the Congress is meeting fewer days this year than they've had in a long while, that this will really pass. We are faced with a drug epidemic. I don't know how it is out here in the Midwest, but the number one issue in New Hampshire during the presidential race was heroin in New Hampshire. I have a daughter that lives up in Maine, and up in Maine it is an epidemic. So the Colson Commission was bipartisan, and I think lays out a whole series of recommendations, and Speaker Ryan is for it. So I think very positive. And just to put a good word in for Speaker Ryan, working with AEI has laid out a anti-poverty plan, a little different than maybe somebody on a different party might think, but the guy, Ryan, is a very honest, ethical, decent, sincere guy. So I think you ought to watch the recommendations that Ryan is putting out with regard to poverty. But I think the opportunity on the prison reform and the drug issue is of being successful in a bipartisan way is very, very high. I would be shocked if this Congress adjourns without passing it.
Mr. Hall, the Food for Peace Reform Act, S-525, came before the Senate on February 12, 2015. I wrote on it this last fall, and it is still in committee. Do you support this bill, and is this delay indicative of the lack of concern you mentioned?
What's the name of this bill?
It's the Food for Peace Reform Act, S-525.
I'm not familiar with this bill. I haven't been in Congress since 2002, so I am very familiar with Food for Peace, and I've been familiar with Food for Peace for 35 years, but I'm not familiar with this new law that they're talking about. What does this do?
If I could have a follow-up question from the person who wrote that with a little more specificity, I'll ask that as a follow-up. And while we're waiting on that, yes.
The Reform Act is looking at redoing certain parts of Title II of the U.S. aid program. Part of it will include more work with shipping other than just specific U.S. merchant ships, as well as procuring food within those nations and regions instead of shipping U.S. domestic overproduction.
Okay. So we're talking about basically shipping food on ships other than U.S. ships, and where we demand and have for the longest time demanded that our food be shipped on U.S. ships, which increases the price of food, increases the price of helping the hungry, and I'm for that. That legislation might also be What also might be part of that legislation too, and I'm not sure, it demands too that we make an effort to buy the local produce. I think it has that in it too, which I favor. If the farmers have the food available, that we buy it from them rather than ship it all the way over from the United States. Sometimes we can't do that. When I was ambassador in Rome, we had a major drought in South Africa, and six or seven nations, we had to bring our food all the way from the United States, all the way to South Africa and many of the countries in South Africa, and we couldn't buy the food locally. So it wasn't a problem. There was no disruption of food or no disruption of the price. And so sometimes we cannot buy the food locally. We have to bring it from the United States. But if we can change, if we can change the regulations relative to shipping on any ships that we want rather than American ships, the unions are going to be mad at that, you know, because they demand that we ship on our own ships, I mean, on maritime, on American ships, it ups the price. it's probably a pretty good bill, but I'm not familiar with it. I mean, I haven't studied it, so I don't know the ins and outs of it. But if that's the gist of it, I'm for it.
Mr. Wolf, we are in a highly visible, highly volatile, and contentious presidential election cycle. I've got a couple of questions relative to that. The first question is this. What do you think about Trumpism among evangelicals? And by Trumpism, I imagine that means pro-Trump. And secondly, do you think evangelicals support Trump? And lastly, what is your opinion about the phenomenon of Donald Trump?
Well, I think I'm going to answer the question this way. I supported John Kasich in the Republican primary in the state of Virginia. John Kasich was in a Bible study with me and with Tony. He's honest, ethical, decent, moral, a strong believer. And I think Kasich has offered what I think is the best approach for the country. And so, you know, I'm not going to get into criticizing and this. I'm going to kind of let that thing go. You know, even in the 34 years that I ran, I got a lot of criticism from my opponents, but I didn't criticize back. So I'm just not going to get into it. I think John Kasich, I'm not trying to influence you all, because I assume you've already voted because the Illinois primary is over, but John Kasich is somebody who I think has provided the leadership, the tone. He's balanced the budget. He's not talking about doing something that he's going to do. For 5 years, we actually paid down the debt. He was on the Armed Services Committee. He has extensive experience. He is a very conservative man, yet he was able to walk across. I'm very conservative. I was able to walk across the aisle. I consider Nancy Pelosi a friend of mine. Nancy Pelosi, I didn't agree with Nancy on a lot of things, but I, and so Kasich has that ability. So I think what the country needs at this time is John Kasich.
Thank you. And in the spirit of bipartisan cooperation and amity, I'd like to pose the same questions to Mr. Hall.
You know, I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to do the same thing that Frank did. You know, for years, Frank and I publicly, we have never, in a public sense, we don't talk about other people publicly. We're not going to do that now. And we're here in an audience that is that loves the Lord, and we're here to talk about, you know, we're here to talk about our respective issues and our relationship. So I'll be doggone if I'm going to talk about partisan politics in front of you when I never did it as a congressman. And I never blasted, and I was never mean. I never was personal against my opponent. And so I'm not going to do it to you either.
Okay? Interesting thing. In our group, you can tell, our group broke up once. Because you get a group of dentists together, they're going to talk about the new dental drill. You get a group of doctors together, they're going to talk about the new stethoscope. We start to talk about politics. So Tony just said, I didn't come here to talk about politics. So our group really did break up. And so we always, you know, we then start talking about...
We came back together.
Yeah, we came back together.
We came back together, but I said, if we're going to talk about politics, I don't want anything to do with this group because I talk about politics all day long. I'm here talking about Jesus. I want to learn about I want to learn what he says. I want to learn what the scripture has to say. I mean, why do I want to talk about Trump to you? Why would I want to say something mean? I'm not going to do that. I have never done it. I might tell you privately what I think, but I'm not going to tell you publicly.
Thank you for that winsome example. On behalf of the Wheaton Center for Faith, Politics, and Economics, I have a small token of my appreciation. You're no longer in Congress. It's just no more than $20 in value. Because I do remember the old federal ethics rules. But on a very serious note, gentlemen, Meredith, thank you so much for this evening.